Hello gentlemen, this is CS MGTOW. Today I'm going to be showing you a demonstration of magic by the celebrated professor and feminist Daphna Joel from Tel Aviv University. You see, during her recent discussion, Daphna literally does the impossible, and that is to make neurological sex differences disappear. Sometimes with the illusion of obfuscation, sometimes with just outright lies, and sometimes by leaving out important studies which do not support her position. It's important to firstly note that Professor Daphna Joel describes herself as a neuroscientist.
As a neuroscientist,
this is her first area of skullduggery and represents a clear and blatant attempt to increase her credibility and lend weight to a number of very unscientific claims, which she will of course be presenting in very short order. You see, according to her university biography page, she holds a PhD in psychology. No additional qualifications are listed.
Did you know that 15 minutes of stress are enough to change the sex of some regions of the brain from the male form to the female form, or from the female form to the male form? I didn't know that either.
Here, Daphna simply lies. It is the first of many such lies, half-truths, that unfortunately litter this video and her overall thesis. You see, although she did not cite a source here, I was actually able to locate the study that this claim is based upon. So, just to be clear here, Professor Daphna Joel suggests that just 15 minutes of stress is enough to change the sex of some regions of the brain from the male to the female form. This is a claim that is extrapolated from a body of work by Cecilia Pyer, who in 2011 published a paper titled "Are Increased Levels of Self-Reported Psychological Stress, Anxiety, and Depression Associated with Fertility Problems?" It's the first study of its kind, and the experts who conducted the study found that high levels of the stress hormone cortisol were associated with the birth of more girls than boys. Some 338 women from around the UK who were trying to get pregnant kept diaries about their lives, relationships, and sex lives, and completed questionnaires about how stressed they felt. I know, you can already see the problems here. Asking women how stressed they felt, that's certainly going to lead to accurate answers. Sure. So, just to recap here, the research in question was not designed to answer the question of hormone levels on child neurology. It was designed to look at the impact of a number of stressors on child gender, to which the authors concluded that the difference in the sexes was not actually significant overall. Secondly, it was a very, very small sample size of 338 women, of whom gave birth to a grand total of 58 boys and 72 girls. Thirdly, the research relied on notoriously unreliable participant self-reported measures of psychological stress, anxiety, and depression, and associated these with fertility problems. So Professor Daphna Joel then incorrectly claims that just 15 minutes of stress is enough to change the sex of some regions of the brain from the male form to the female form. Lastly, and perhaps most problematically, she fails to discuss which regions of the brain are actually changed, to what extent, and what should be considered, at least from her point of view, the male form or the female form.
But when I discovered this fact, it transformed the way I was thinking about sex and brain. It all started about 4 years ago when I decided to give a course on the psychology of gender. I stayed home for almost a year and read books and scientific papers on the development of men and women from the moment of conception. As a neuroscientist, I was of course interested in the relation between sex and brain. I soon found out that many scientists, just like most of us, believe that there are male brains and female brains, and that this is the reason for the fundamental differences between men and women. According to a very popular version of this story, the female brain has a large emotion center and a large communication center. It is hardwired for empathy. The male brain, on the other hand, has a large aggression center and a large sex center. It is hardwired for building systems. Maybe you have thought of something else, but this is a scientific theory after all. This is a very popular theory, or very popular story, because it gives us a very simple explanation to the world we live in. It explains why women are more sensitive and emotional, and men more aggressive and sexual. Why most teachers are women, and most engineers, men. Already in the womb, the story continues, a huge surge of testosterone transforms the brain of the male fetus from the default female form to the male form. So boys are born with a male brain, and girls are born with a female brain. Whereas the notion of a male brain and the female brain fits well the popular view of men from Mars, women from Venus, it does not fit scientific data, which tell us that men and women are remarkably similar. In the past 50 years or so, over 50,000 papers have been published on sex differences in psychology. I haven't read them all, even a year is not enough, but others have. And their conclusion, based on this enormous number of studies, is that men and women are highly similar in almost everything psychologists can measure. Intellectual abilities, cognitive abilities, emotional abilities, personality characteristics, interests, and attitudes.
Here, Professor Daphna Joel is either ignorant of or deliberately ignoring the available evidence that there are indeed documented and well-known differences in the male and female brain. In the largest study of its kind, Werner and colleagues, including co-authors Ruben Gurr, a professor of psychology in the Department of Psychiatry, Raquel Gurr, who's also a professor of psychiatry, neurology, and radiology. So these individuals investigated gender-specific differences in brain connectivity during the course of development of 949 individuals, of which 521 were female, 428 were male. The individuals were aged between 8 to 22 years, and they used something known as DTI, which is diffusion tensor imaging. And apparently, DTI is a water-based imaging technique that can trace and highlight the fiber pathways connecting the different regions of the brain, laying the foundation for a structural connectome or network of the whole brain. So in the study, the researchers found that the females displayed greater connectivity in the supratentorial region, which contains the cerebrum, the largest part of the brain, between the left and the right hemisphere. Males, on the other hand, displayed greater connectivity within each hemisphere. By contrast, the opposite prevailed in the cerebellum, the part of the brain that plays a major role in motor control, where males displayed greater interhemispheric connectivity and females displayed greater intra-hemispheric connectivity. These connections likely give men an efficient system versus women for coordinated action, where the cerebellum and the cortex participate in bridging between the perceptual experiences in the back of the brain and action in the front of the brain, according to the authors. So female connections likely facilitate integration of the analytic and the sequential processing modes of the left hemisphere with the spatial, intuitive, and information processing modes in the right side of the brain. And this is all according to the authors. So right now on the screen, I'm displaying an image taken from the article in question, and that's a neural map of the typical male brain. And here we have a neural map of the typical female brain. And you'll notice that these are not the same things. There are differences here. There is such a thing, according to the available evidence, and it's pretty incontrovertible, There is such a thing as a male brain that is uniquely different to a female brain. And the authors commented that past studies have shown sex differences in the brain, specifically in relation to, number one, brain size. The male brain absolutely is typically about, on average, of course, 10% larger than the female brain. Secondly, in the area of mathematical skills, the inferior parietal lobule, which controls numerical brain function, is larger in males than females. Thirdly, with spatial abilities, the parietal region is thicker in that of the female, making it harder for them to mentally rotate objects, an important, you know, spatial skill. Women often report difficulty with spatial tasks, both on tests and in real life. And fourthly, susceptibility to brain function disorders. Men are more likely to be dyslexic or have other language disabilities since they're more often left brain dominant. Males are also more prone to autism, ADHD, and Tourette syndrome, while women are more susceptible to mood disorders like anxiety and depression. For a more in-depth treatment of this incredibly important issue, I put the link in the description bar to two very, very important papers, one by Verma and colleagues, which I've cited in this paper, and that's titled Sex Differences in the Structural Connectome of the Human Brain, and the other by Anna Kalzoska, I hope I'm pronouncing that correctly, and colleagues titled Gender Differences in Neurological Disease. So, hey, based on the available evidence, is there such a thing as a male and a female brain? Yes, abso-fucking-lutely. You will also notice, of course, that Daphna Joel has simply failed to cite a single study. She has failed to name a single researcher so far, failed to explain how a single study that her thesis rests upon was designed, what were its limitations or objectives. Instead, she resorts to vague references to many studies and scientists. Whether this is deliberate manipulation or simply a lack of respect on her part for the cognitive abilities of her audience is actually rather difficult to determine, but nevertheless, pretty damning.
Already at the end of the 19th century, scientists discovered a difference between the brains of men and the brains of women. They discovered that the brains of men were, on average, larger than the brains of women.
Okay, now I'm extremely confused. You see, Daphna has just spent the last 4.5 minutes trying to persuade the audience that there are no sex differences in the human brain. Now she states that by the end of the 19th century, scientists actually found differences, specifically size differences, in the brains of men and women. Now, based on her hypothesis, she is suggesting that these size differences in the brain between the genders have absolutely no bearing whatsoever on their respective cognitive abilities, interests, or behaviors. But being a scientist, whom I assume accepts that there are differences between the species, how would she explain, let's say, the majority of differences between orangutans, gorillas, you know, the great apes, including humans, versus lesser apes such as gibbons, if not at least primarily based on the differences in the brain, or very, very specifically the size of the brain?
Some scientists took this as evidence to support and explain the then widely held belief that men are smarter than women.
Now, that's simply a level of dishonesty that is quite nauseating to see an academic sink to. According to Daphna's estimate, these scientists found that there were indeed differences in the brains of men and women according to size. And for this reason alone, they decided that men were smarter than women. That's right, they ignored the fact that men had almost single-handedly innovated us out of the Stone Age. That not only did men possess larger brains, but men also, as a result of these larger brains, possessed higher IQs. For example, a 2004 meta-analysis by Richard Lynn and Paul Irwin, published in 2005, found that the mean IQ of men exceeded that of women by up to 5 points on the Raven's Progressive Metrics Test. or the work of Jackson and Philip Rushton, who found that males aged between the ages of 17 and 18 had on average 3.63 IQ points in excess of their female equivalents on the Scholastic Assessment Test.
One scientist even went as far as stating that women, because of their small brain, do not have the intellectual and academic skills necessary for academic studies.
On this particular issue, I believe this unnamed scientist has been proven right. When one analyzes the dropout rate of women in science, engineering, and technology, that is absolutely, completely factual. In fact, an article titled Stopping the Exodus of Women in Science was published in the Harvard Business Review, and it addresses this, you know, very specific issue. Apparently, over time, 52% of these women quit their jobs for easier pursuits. And I'm going to guess that, you know, it's homemaking or working for an NGO of some sort. And The Guardian also reported that only 12% of third-year female PhD students want a career in academia. And as always, of course, all of the links to the articles and studies used to make this video are in the description bar.
If this logic sounds familiar, this is not an accident. This is the same belief we started with, that men and women are fundamentally different because men have male brains and women have female brains. However, this is an old version of the myth, so it sounds absurd.
No, it doesn't. It actually makes sense and is backed up by the available scientific evidence.
To date, when women not only go to universities, but outnumber men at all levels of academic studies...
That's a logical fallacy known as non sequitur. It does not follow that because more women are going to university, that scientists were wrong about women being unsuited for academia. More women going to university has to do with a number of factors, including a deliberate push by universities to enroll female students, often through active and passive affirmative quotas. The myriad of women-only grants made available to female candidates, the fact that universities, attendance these days at least, carries very, very little upfront financial cost. I mean, there's a huge loan, but there's a very, very small initial barrier to entry. Back when these scientists made that statement, academia was a place where real discoveries were expected to be made. You often had to pay for the privilege of being there. You had to pay very, very heavily to secure your PhD. Tenure was yet to be established, and you were expected to make a major contribution to the field. It was a meritocracy in its purest form, and you needed a very, very high IQ to join this club. Having women make up 50% of university enrollees may actually go some way to explaining why modern academia has become a breeding ground of regressive leftist ideology and censorship while simultaneously delivering little of value to society, which of course funds it. Or to put it simply, we have reduced the barriers to entry in universities. We've built up so many universities to the point that those outside of the very, very top IQ percentiles can attend, so more women are attending as a result of this. And I'm not making a value judgment here. If anybody wants to attend a university, that's completely and utterly your thing. I'm just pointing out what I observe based on the available data.
In the more than 100 years that have passed, scientists continue to discover differences between the brains of males and females in both humans and animals. For example, compared to men, women have a thicker cortex, a higher proportion of gray matter, and a lower proportion of white matter. Compared to women, men have larger ventricles, these big holes you see in the brain.
Okay, this is where this video becomes rather bizarre. Well, now I'm really, really confused. You said, Daphna, that there is no such thing as a female or a male brain. So what about these anatomical differences you're pointing to here?
I see that some of you that were very happy to discover about the fact that men have bigger brains than women are not really happy with this discovery. And I can understand this, because if you believe, like the scientists from the 19th century, that the size of the brain matters, then indeed you will be embarrassed to discover that your bigger brains come together with a bigger, what shall we call them, empty spaces? But I want to convey the message that this is all nonsense. Men do just fine with their larger ventricles. Just as women do just fine with their smaller brains.
This is actually not the case. In Western society, a little discussed fact is that without a constant subsidy by men in all facets of life, women would simply find themselves unable to cope, as highlighted by a full fact study, which is the UK's independent fact-checking charity. And according to their article, which is titled, "Are Women Paying 60% Less Income Tax Than Men?" they went on to say, in the last tax year, men paid £92 billion in income tax, whereas women paid £36.8 billion, which is 60% less. And the article went on to state that there are more women in the workforce than ever, yet they still contribute 60% less in income tax than men. And Harriet Baldwin, who, if you happen to live in the UK, you'll know her, she's actually quite a popular politician over here. She's the MP for West Worcester. She posed this same question to Vince Cable in Parliament a few days after the article was published, stating, and this is a quote, "Normally I'm in favour of lower income taxes, but in this case, will the Secretary of State explain what else he is doing to help equalize these figures, and more importantly, bring in an extra £55 billion into the exchequer?" That is what women should have been paying, based on the fact that they make up, you know, pretty much what, half of the labor force. So from these HMRC, that's our UK tax body statistics, it also emerges that the number of female income taxpayers has actually gone down since the recession, from 14.2 million in 2007-2008 to 13 million in the current financial year when this paper was published, which was 2012/2013. And I should also add, of course, that the number of male taxpayers has also dropped from 18.2 million in 2007-2008 to 17 million presently, which was 2012-2013, when this paper was penned. The gap, of course, looks far more pronounced when we break down these figures by income bracket. So in an age where women make up the majority, that's nearly 60% of university graduates, according to the numbers cited by Daphna Joel, these same women pay 60% less in income tax than men. So, Professor Daphna Joel, women don't do just fine without men paying for things, investing, inventing, and, you know, just working. There'll actually be very, very little for women to consume.
We now know of hundreds of differences between the brains of men and women. Not just differences in the size, as I've just shown you, but also differences in the microanatomy of the brain, and I'll show you an example shortly. And as more and more differences have been discovered, the belief that there is a male brain and the female brain has become stronger and stronger, because everyone was taking for granted the assumption that these differences were adding one to the other, as I've depicted in this figure. At first, this sounded completely logical to me. There are many differences between the brains of males and females, so there must be a male brain and a female brain. But then I read the paper I told you about in the beginning, the one that found that stress can change the sex of the brain, and I realized that this logic was flawed. Let's look at this study together. In this study, the researchers were interested in the effects of stress on a brain region called the hippocampus. They measured the density of dendritic spines. You see here a dendrite with its, a neuron, excuse me, with its dendrite, and the small red dots are the dendritic spines. And here we can see an actual dendrite from a male rat and a dendrite from a female rat. And I added red arrows so it is easier to detect the spines. And we can clearly see a sex difference. Males have fewer spines compared to females. Cherish this moment. This is the first time you actually get to see a sex difference in the brain. So we can say that dendrites in this region have a male form, which is sparse spines, and the female form, which is dense spines. There was another group of rats in this study. These rats were stressed for 15 minutes, as long as this talk. So you can think what is happening to my brain now. And here we can see a dendrite from a stressed male and a dendrite from a stressed female. Strangely enough, the dendrite from the stressed male has what we have just termed the female form, that is, lots of spines. And the dendrite from the stressed female has what we have just termed the male form, which is few spines. So we see that the form of dendrites in this region depends on sex. It is different in males and in females. But it does not depend only on sex. Knowing that the dendrite you are looking at is from a female is not enough to predict the form of the dendrite, whether it will have few spines or lots of spines. To predict this, you also need to know whether this female was under stress or wasn't. So although sex is important, it is the interaction of sex and environment, in this case stress, that determines the form of neurons in this region.
Okay, here it's very important to make note of a number of things that Professor Joel has conveniently glossed over. Firstly, the study in question by Tracy Shores, Chadwick Chua, and Jacqueline Falduto was conducted in rats. That's right, this wasn't a human study. I've attached the link to both the article and screenshots of this paper in question. Nowhere in the article do the authors suggest that these results can be extrapolated to humans. And this actually represents a very, very clear flaw with Professor Joel's thesis. Secondly, and this is the part that I just couldn't believe, it's quite shocking that she can use the data from this study as an argument against brain differences in sex. If anything, the data clearly reinforces sexual dimorphism of the brain, as the male and female brains have inverse responses to stress in these studies, in that they are performing in opposition to one another under stressful conditions. How is another psychological difference observed in any way an argument against the very differences? Thirdly, and just as importantly, she fails to explain in any way if or to what extent dendritic spines influence sexually dimorphic behavior. And of course, I'm not a neuroscientist here. I'm just a layperson. But I think it's incredibly important if she's going to come along and make these claims, she needs to explain the significance of this, you know, in impacting very, very specifically the male brain or the female brain or the lack thereof. Fourth, Professor Joel has, for all intents and purposes, and I'm sure you've caught this, but I think I should point it out, she's just declared evolution to be a cruel hoax. That's right, a cruel Shakespearean hoax. And she's done this by basically saying that the genders, due to their anatomical and neurological differences, did not have to adapt to different psychological strategies to the survival pressures they faced.
As you may imagine, I was very surprised by this study. So I started to look for other similar studies. It wasn't really hard to find them. There were studies reporting similar effects of stress when the stress was experienced in utero, just after birth, and in adulthood. There were also similar effects following other manipulations. For example, whether the rats were housed individually or in groups, whether they had things to play with or didn't. The different manipulations affected many brain regions, not just the hippocampus, and many features of the brain, such as the size, number of neurons, and dendritic morphology, as I've just shown you.
This is all well and good. However, what you've done here, Professor Joel, is to show that stress affects dendritic spine density in the male versus female hippocampus of rats. I fail to see how this supports an argument that there is no such thing as a male or female brain. irrespective of the biochemical process by which a male or a female brain is arrived at, once it is arrived at, it's a specific, measurable, and absolutely impactful difference.
What was common to all of these studies was the finding that whatever the manipulation, some features of the brain changed their sex, and some didn't. You may be wondering now, so what is the meaning of talking about the sex of a brain region if we see that simple manipulations can reverse what is male and what is female? You are absolutely right. It is meaningless to talk of a male form and a female form. It makes much more sense, it's much more reasonable and rational to use informative terms such as sparse versus dense, high versus low, long versus short. But I will continue to use this male-female terminology because this will help me make my point clear. Let's go back now to the male fetus and to the testosterone surge that is transforming his brain from the female form to the male form. And add only one component, stress. Picture the fetus mother. During the long weeks of pregnancy, she sometimes experiences stress, not all the time, but sometimes she experiences stress. Whenever she does, some features of her fetus brain change their sex.
This is actually becoming quite sad. This study was conducted in rats, as I pointed out earlier, and what Professor Joel is now doing is extrapolating the findings to humans. Furthermore, and just as importantly, she's failed to address the impact of the changes undergone by the dendritic spine on the brains.
So when her boy is born, his brain is a mosaic of both male and female characteristics. This mosaic is uniquely his, molded by the complex interactions of his hormones with the environment he has been living in up until now. The same is true for the female fetus. Her brain is also molded by complex interactions of hormones and environment, so that the little girl is also born with a mosaic or brain mosaic composed of female and male characteristics. So we see that we are already born with a brain which is neither male nor female. It is intersex, that is a mixture of both male and female characteristics.
Just because the division between male and female behavior is not absolutely binary doesn't mean a binary is absent. It's a spectrum, it's a distribution curve, if you will. A spectrum doesn't mean a classification is meaningless. It just means that, you know, it's on a distribution curve.
This, or our intersex brain, will continue to change throughout our life as a result of our unique experiences. We can now add to the image of ourselves as a unique mosaic of masculine and feminine characteristics the image of our brain being a unique mosaic of male and female characteristics. I will close with this. Many people believe that there are male brains and female brains because this belief gives them an explanation to why men and women are so different and why they should behave differently and be treated differently. I have shown you today that it is meaningless to talk of the sex of the brain. Brains do not have sex. If you must relate to the brain's sex, you can call it intersex, a mixture of male and female characteristics. There are no male brains and no female brains. Therefore, their existence cannot explain fundamental differences between men and women, which is not really a big problem, considering the fact that men and women are remarkably similar. Be yourself. Thank you.
So, according to Professor Joel, there's no such thing as a male or a female brain. So, brain differences cannot explain the differences between men and women. This brings us nicely to the crux of this video, and that is what motivates women in academia wanting to make sex differences disappear. Well, It's rather simple, and that is, despite the affirmative action programs that funnel the majority of available tax monies on these areas to women's programs, despite the laws that criminalize any behavior by men that women don't like, despite the fact that women now out-earn men due to a myriad of laws and quotas and affirmative action hires and legislation which allow them to sue employers on a whim for constructive dismissal or sexual harassment or discrimination, despite the fact that women make up the majority of university graduates, despite all of these, men are still making and doing any and everything of real importance in this world. As the men at the European Space Agency proudly celebrated landing a spacecraft on a comet for the very, very first time in history, incredible achievement, women consoled themselves by celebrating forcing the lead astrophysicist, Dr. Matt Taylor, to apologize for images on a $20 cotton t-shirt. It's the deep, unshakable inferiority complex of an envious, younger, venomous sibling. This is the basis for the cries of neurosexism and the ridiculous TEDx talk delivered by Professor Joel. Thank you very, very much. This is C.S. MGTOW.